Good morning. We're a little early this morning, but I wanted to play some music for you and to show that we do have a CCLI license to play this. So hopefully they won't stop us from playing it. So yes, that was the CCLI license, and I will be playing Praise You in the Storm by Casting Crowns. Again, here's the license.
I was sure by now that you would have reached down and wiped our tears away, stepped in and saved the day. But once again, I say amen, and it's still. As the thunder rolls, I barely hear you whisper through the rain, I'm with you. And as your mercy falls, I'll raise my hands and praise the God who gives and takes away. And I'll praise you in this storm, and I will lift my hands. You
Good morning and welcome. It's nice to see so many of you here and saying hi to each other. It's a lovely day, this third Sunday of Lent in the year B. And the dogs are excited to see you here too. So if you can hear them or see them, that's what it is. And in case any of you were wondering, earlier I held up the certificate from CCLI to play that music, so hopefully they won't block it today. Couple of announcements. The sanctuary candle, which is represented here by this candle, but is lit in the sanctuary, is given to the glory of God and in loving memory of Oneida and Stanley Stevens by Bob and Jill Stevens, and in loving memory of Byron Berenger by his daughter Sherry Gallivan and granddaughter Georgia, and in loving memory of George and Blanche Williams by Barbara and Byron Williams. And Barbara and Byron Williams have some more lovely news to announce. They now have a lovely granddaughter born healthy and well last Monday. So congratulations to Barb and Byron on your new granddaughter. We also, tomorrow is International Women's Day. So this deanery is actually hosting an International Women's Day special talk, and it is on Zoom. If you go to your weekly announcements, you'll see the Zoom link, and it is about human trafficking. Of course, the Bread and Butter Club is continuing, so if you can manage to donate something to that, please do. It is a worthy cause. We provide bread and usually margarine or buns or hot dog buns, hamburger buns, whatever we have the money for, but they could use 50 loaves of bread and 50 tubs of margarine each month. So if you can help, please donate, even $10, and mark your offering to the Bread and Butter Club, or you can add it on to your automatic withdrawals. Just mention that it's for the Bread and Butter Club. All right, we are doing morning prayer this morning. However, because we are in yellow, we are considering next week to have a live service in the church where you are invited to come. Of course, there will be all the safe church rules. You have to sit at least 6 feet apart. We're only allowed so many people. So if you'd like to join us, please contact me and I will save you a seat. You will be screened at the door. You will remain in your seat for the service, but we will be doing Holy Communion. And again, it is as safe as possible because you will only receive the bread. And I will come to you in your pews so there won't be movement around. I'm looking forward to actually seeing you in St. James. So again, contact me if you wish to come next week. This week, we are doing morning prayer out of the Book of Alternative Services. So if you have your book, please turn to page 45. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Dear friends in Christ, as we prepare to worship Almighty God, let us with penitent and obedient hearts confess our sins, that we may obtain forgiveness by his infinite goodness and mercy. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We continue with morning prayer, and one little note about the announcements. We will continue to live stream, even when we get back to the church. Lord, open our lips,
And our mouth shall proclaim your praise.
O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy. O come, let us worship. Let us join together in the Veneti. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and raise a loud shout to him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the caverns of the earth, and the heights of the hills are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands have molded the dry land. Come, let us bow down and bend the knee, and kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today you would hearken to his voice. We continue with our psalm, which today is Psalm 19. So we will read it responsively by full verse. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork.
One day tells its tale to another, and one night imparts knowledge to another.
Although they have no words or language, and their voices are not heard,
their sound has gone out into all lands, and their message to the ends of the world.
In the deep has he set a pavilion for the sun. It comes forth like a bridegroom out of his chamber. It rejoices like a champion to run its course.
It goes forth from the uttermost edge of the heavens and runs about to the end of it again. Nothing is hidden from its burning heat.
The law of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to the innocent.
The statutes of the Lord are just and rejoice the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear and gives light to the eyes.
The fear of the Lord is clean and endures forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether.
More to be desired are they than gold, much more than fine gold, sweeter far than honey in a comb.
By them also is your servant enlightened, and in keeping them there is great reward.
Who can tell how often he offends? Cleanse me from my secret faults.
Above all, keep your servant from presumptuous sins. Let them not get dominion over me. Then shall I be whole and sound and innocent of a great offense.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
And together we pray. Gracious Creator of heaven and earth, your word has come among us as the true Son of righteousness, and the good news of his birth has gone out to the ends of the world. Open our eyes to the light of your law, that we may be purified from sin and serve you without reproach for the sake of Jesus Christ, our light and our life. A reading from Exodus. Then God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in the heaven above, or that is on the earth below, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents to the third and the fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land of the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from 1 Corinthians. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where's the scribe? Where's the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs and Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles, but to those who are the called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the Gospel of John. The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, take these things out of here. Stop making my father's house a marketplace. His disciples remembered that it was written, zeal for your house will consume me. The Jews then said to him, what sign can you show us for doing this? Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. The Jews then said, this temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days? But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Have you ever been so angry that you could just throw things or yell or scream and turn tables over or clear the room? A few weeks ago, Hershey, our little dog, well, Sherry's little dog, needed to go outside at 2 a.m. Well, it happens, so I got out of bed and let him out the back into the backyard. I understand. When you have to go, you have to go. You can't always wait till morning. Of course, Cassie, my lab puppy, decided that if Hershey was going out, so was she. So out she went. So far, so good. Hershey did his business and came back in. Cassie, however, decided it was playtime. She would come to the door, I would open it, and off she would run. Not once, not twice, but time and time again. At 2 a.m. After several attempts to get her in, I decided to go back to bed. She could let me know when she was ready to actually come in. A few minutes later, I heard her bark at the door, so up I got. Sure enough, she was standing at the door. So I opened it, and off she ran again. This time, I tried bribery. Dog treats of ever-increasing size with each try. Cassie would get close to the door, almost to where I could grab her, and then off she'd dart. Not even food worked. I was getting frustrated, to say the least. The door was being slammed shut each time now. Trying to calm down, I decided to lay down on the couch until she deigned to come in. But something caught Cassie's attention, and she decided to bark. By now, it was 3 o'clock in the morning. The last thing I wanted was neighbors being woken up, so I tried again to bring her in. I even went outside in the cold in my pajamas and slippers to try to bring her in. She would again come close to me, but then she'd dart off. At 4 o'clock in the morning, I finally got Cassie inside. Let me tell you, I was angry. Sherry came up from her downstairs bedroom to see what was going on, and how she managed to sleep through all that, I have no idea. I grabbed the dog by the collar and dragged her into my bedroom and shut the door. It took me several hours to calm down. All this because my dog wanted to play rather than come inside. But I was tired and I wanted to sleep. I didn't want to cause problems with the neighbors, and I felt disrespected by my dog. What was going through Jesus's mind as he cleared the temple, when he made a whip of cords and chased them out of the temple, when he overturned the tables and poured out the money? What was he thinking? In this pericope, the story is one of a few that are retold in all four of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Today we read John. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their temples. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling the doves, "Take these out of here. Stop making my father's house a marketplace." Matthew's version says, "Then Jesus entered the temple and drove out all who were selling and buying in the temple, and he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. He said to them, 'It is written, my house shall be called a house of prayer, but you're making it a den of robbers.'" Mark says, "Then they came to Jerusalem, and he entered the temple and began to drive out those who were selling and those who were buying in the temple. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. And he would not allow anyone to carry anything through the temple. He was teaching and saying, 'Is it not written, my house is to be called a house of prayer for all the nations, but you have made it a den of robbers?'" And finally, Luke, "Then he entered the temple and began to drive out those who were selling things there. And he said, 'It is written, my house shall be a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of robbers.'" It can be very enlightening to look at the different versions to see what's the same and what is different. It's usually Mark who's brief and to the point, but this time it's Luke, the physician. But each person recounts that Jesus went into the temple and drove out the people who were selling there. Matthew and Mark add the people who were buying to those who Jesus chased out. He also specifically mentions those who sell doves. Matthew, Mark, and John all specify the money changers as problems too. John's the only one to mention Jesus making a whip, and he is also the only one to mention cattle and sheep. So what was Jesus so upset about? All four Gospels blame the people selling things. So what were they selling, and why did it make Jesus angry? In Matthew, Mark, and Luke, Jesus is nearing the end of his life. He's entered Jerusalem in triumph. And then he does this. The clergy would not look kindly on Jesus causing this upset so close to Passover. They needed people to be able to offer sacrifices, and these salespeople made it possible. Many of the people traveled great distances, and bringing animals would have been difficult. So being able to buy them at the temple made it convenient. And the people needed money they could offer at the temple, and Roman money would not be acceptable. So they needed temple money that didn't have any graven image on it. So what was the problem? Weren't these entrepreneurs just offering a necessary service? Well, Imagine, if you will, we are actually in the church building. A new rule has come out that you must offer an animal when you come to church, and I can only accept a special currency made especially for offering at the church. Most of us don't keep animals, so we'd have to buy one. So some people set up stands on the church property selling animals. Others set up stands to exchange money for church money. Each Sunday, more and more people bring animals to sell, and more money changers set up tables. They get closer and closer to the church. Then one bravely brings their table just inside the door of the church. They aren't getting in the way, so nobody stops them. After all, the less time we have to control the animal on our own, the better, right? And the money changer is convenient if we get all the way into the church before we realize we have to change money. The next week, a few more sellers come to the church and are now lined up along the back of the church. The service is frequently interrupted with animals making noises, or maybe even getting loose and running around. A few pigeons fly overhead while we're worshiping, making messes, as pigeons do. It all happens so gradually that we don't stop to think about it until it gets to the point where we can't even worship because of the sellers and their wares. To top it all off, these same vendors have realized they have a captive market and raise their prices beyond what is fair or reasonable. But people pay because they don't have a choice if they want to worship God. It's so easy for things to get out of hand, isn't it? It wasn't Cassie's fault, she teased at the door. One of the games we had played involved her getting close to me and then me chasing her off. And yet, I was angry at her. I was the one at fault. Jesus was angry at the vendors at the temple. But was it their fault? Or were they just meeting a need? Wasn't it the fault of the clergy who allowed the sales to occur and who were to blame, especially as they turned a blind eye to the overcharging? Once I realized the effects of my game with Cassie, it was my responsibility to change. Once the clergy realized the effects of allowing the vendors to overcharge and infringe on sacred space, it was their responsibility to change. Instead, they plotted to kill Jesus. Do we do that? When we are confronted with our sins, do we get angry and lash out? Do we try to kill the messenger instead of repenting and working towards change? Next time we find ourselves angry, or if someone is angry with us, let's vow to stop and discover why we are so angry. Sometimes it's us who needs to change. And with God's help, we can. Let's turn to page 53 in our Book of Alternative Services. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. This is the first and the great commandment. The second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. I'm going to turn this over to Sherry for the intercessions and thanksgivings.
Gathering all that commands our prayers, let us intercede with our gracious God, saying, have mercy, O Lord. For the church, that God's commandments may be ever close to us, wonderful to ponder, and life-giving to keep, we pray, have mercy, O Lord. For our divided and restless world, that those who hold power over others may be troubled and transformed by the demands of justice, we pray, Have mercy, O Lord. For children, that infants and young people of every nation may have food, shelter, and learning, and that they may love their world, we pray. Have mercy, O Lord. For this virtually gathered community, that the solemn brightness of Lent may open our eyes to these times, our foolishness, and our worth, we pray.
Have mercy, O Lord.
For those who are ill and recovering in mind, body, or spirit, especially remembering Norma, Sam, Iva, Sadie, Edna, Sophie, Bob, Georgia, and others known to us. That you, Lord, will deliver them, we pray.
Have mercy, O Lord.
For all clergy, especially Linda, our primate, Todd, our bishop, and Jenny, our priest and rector, that each one may be a true and faithful servant of Christ, we pray.
Have mercy, O Lord.
For the dying and the dead, especially those who hold close to us and are handed on God's commandment until our day, that they may be at peace, we pray.
Have mercy, O Lord.
For women and girls, God our Creator, you have built up your church through the love and devotion of women everywhere. Inspire us to follow their great example, that we may with them share in the vision of your glory, we pray.
Have mercy, O Lord.
Jealous and merciful God, remember us and all those we hold in our heart. In these 40 days, teach us to do the work of our baptism, and so daily to rise to you the needs of the world. Grant this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Continuing, let us pray. Father of mercy, alone we have no power in ourselves to help ourselves. When we are discouraged by our weakness, strengthen us to follow Christ, our pattern and our hope, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit remain with you and those that you love and those you should love, now and always. Amen. Let us go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. See you next week. God bless.